We are discussing about socialism in Europe and the Russian Revolution. So we talked about what happened in Russia, what were the events or series of events which took place. So there are some certain important dates that we need to discuss before we talk about the revolution of October 1917. So here some important dates are like this: 1850s to 1880s, there were debates over socialism in Russia. It was not all socialism, there were discussions only. Then in 1898, there was a formation of Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party. In 1905, the Bloody Sunday and the Revolution of 1905. In 1917, 2nd March, that is the abdication of the Tsar, and on 24th October, Bolshevik uprising in Petrograd. We have talked about this up till here, but we will be seeing this in a short while, that from 1918 to 20, it was the Civil War. Civil War is the war which is fought between the say parties or the organization or the people inside a country. That is civil war. A normal war is what? When it is fought between two countries or between multiple countries. But civil war is inside the country. People are fighting, maybe various reasons are there. Then in 1919, it was formation of the Comintern. This intern is for international, com is for this communism. Then 1929, it was beginning of collectivization. So we talked about this, all this, and we'll see all this in our discussion. So the revolution of October 1917, so we saw that the provisional government was being formed, and in between Lenin, he was on exile, he came back. So there was a conflict between this provisional government and the Lenin, that is the Bolsheviks. The Lenin feared the provisional government would set up a dictatorship. This is what Lenin feared. So he started a discussion for an uprising against the government. And Bolshevik supporters in the army, Soviet and factories, they were brought together. On 16 October 1917, Lenin persuaded the Petrograd Soviet and Bolshevik party in order to agree to socialist seizure of power. So a military revolution committee, a proper committee, military, which consists of military revolutionary committee was appointed, but the date was not being disclosed. It was kept secret. And the leader was Leon Trotsky. We talked about him earlier also. Now, the uprising began on 24th October. Prime Minister, he was sensing at that time of the provisional government, he was sensing trouble. He was Kerensky. So he left the city in order to summon the troops. What happened in Don? Military men loyal to the government, they seized the building of two Bolshevik newspapers, and pro-government troops were sent to take over these telephone and telegraph offices and protect the winter palace. But as we saw that this military revolution committee, revolutionary committee was already there. So, in a response, a swift response, this military revolution committee ordered its supporter to arrest the minister and seize the government offices. So, later in that day only, same day, there was a ship called Aurora. Aurora shelled the Winter Palace. And other vessels also sailed down this Neva River and took over various military points. And the same day, by the nightfall, the city was under the control of this committee, military revolution committee, and minister finally surrendered. So at a meeting of all Russian Congress of Soviets in Petrograd, a majority approved the Bolshevik action. They said the action was correct. So this was an uprising, and there was a heavy fighting, especially in Moscow. But by December, the Bolshevik controlled the Moscow Petrograd area. Here is a picture, if you see, that we have Lenin here on the left and Trotsky on the right with the workers at Petrograd. So what actually changed after October, because the Bolsheviks are now in control, The Bolshevik was totally opposed to private property. So most of the industry and banks, which were in private hands, they were nationalized in November 1917. That is, the government has the ownership and management. And land was declared social property, and they allowed the peasant to seize the land of the nobility. What happened in the city? The Bolsheviks enforced the partition of large houses so that the other people can also stay there. They banned all the old titles of aristocracy. And in order to assert the change, new uniforms were designed, especially for the army and officials. And it was properly done, proper competition were organized in 1918. And this, you see, this is the result of this cap or this hat. Is the result of one such competition. This is Budeonokwa. Okay. So this is very tough name to spell, Budeonokwa. This is the hat which is very famous, the Soviet hat. Now the Bolshevik Party, it was renamed as Russian Communist Party. And in November 17, the Bolshevik, they conducted the election to the Constituent Assembly. They failed. Then in January 1918, Assembly rejected Bolshevik measures and Lenin dismissed Lenin in return. Lenin dismissed the whole Assembly. He was of that thought that all the Russian Congress of Soviets was more democratic than the Assembly elected in uncertain condition. So in March 1918, though there was opposition from the political allies, Bolshevik made peace with Germany at Brest. Litovsk. And after that, the Bolshevik became the only party to participate in the election to the All Russian Congress of Soviets, which ultimately became the parliament of the country. So Russia now became one party state. Trade unions were under control. There was secret police, this Cheka, and later it was named as OGPU, NKVD. So they punished all those who criticized the Bolsheviks. So this all happened at that time. This is a picture of May Day demonstration in Moscow in 1918. Then the time came for the civil war. When the Bolshevik, because they were opposed for the land owning by nobility, they ordered land redistribution. Now the Russian army, mostly consisting of peasant, the soldiers, they wanted to go home because they wanted that land. Otherwise, they will not get the land. Non-Bolshevik socialists, liberal and supporters of autocracy, they also condemned the Bolshevik uprising which was taking place, which has already took place. So, their leaders moved to South Asia, these, and organized troops to fight the Bolsheviks. That is, you understand, Bolshevik, when they came into, say, a power, the other people or other thoughts like socialist, liberal and supporter of autocracy, they moved to South Russia and organized troops to fight the Bolsheviks. And these Bolsheviks were known as Reds. So, during 1918 and 1919, the Greens, that is the Soviet revolutionaries, and the White, that is the pro-Tsar, they controlled most of the Russian Empire. And they were backed by foreign parties like French, American, British, Japanese troops. So all those forces who were worried at the growth of socialism in Russia, they were interested in this party. So now there was a war, and who were fighting? The Bolsheviks, and there was the other party, which were Greens, that is the social revolutionaries, and there were Whites, which are pro-Tsarist. So these three were in a civil war. The supporters of this private property among these Whites, that is the pro-Tsarist, they took very hard step with peasants who had seized land. And these actions led to the loss of popular support of non-Bolsheviks. By January 1920, the Bolsheviks, after all these civil war, they controlled most of the former Russian Empire. So, they succeeded because, they need to have certain allies also or cooperation also. So with non-Russian nationalities and Muslim Zaydist. So this is how they got back, or most of the regime they took. But in Kiva, in Central Asia, Bolshevik colonists brutally massacred local nationalists in the name of defending this socialism. So now many were confused that what exactly Bolshevik government want, or what Bolshevik means. So what was the remedy? Most non-Russian nationalities were given political autonomy in the Soviet Union, that is USSR, the state the Bolshevik created from the Russian Empire in December 1922. But since this was a combined, you know, with some unpopular policies that the Bolshevik forced the law, local government to follow, like the harsh discouragement of the nomadism. Nomadism means going here and there for the search of livelihood, job, attempt to win over different nationalities. They were just partly successful. They were not entirely successful. So these are certain sources from which we know what we are talking about, that these things happened actually. So autonomy is the right to govern themselves. This is what we talk here. And the nomadism, as I said, the lifestyle of those who do not live in one place but move from area to earn their livelihood. So after that, there was making of socialist society. Because the civil war was there, the Bolshevik kept industries and banks nationalized. They permitted the peasant to cultivate their land that had been socialized, and Bolshevik used confiscated land in order to demonstrate that what collective work is. So the process of centralized planning was introduced at that time. Official actually assessed the economy, they set targets for 5-year period, 5-year plan. And on these, the government fixed all prices in order to promote industrial growth during the first two 5-year plans from 27 to 32, like 1927 to 1932 and 1933 to 1938. So now there was a growth because there was a centralized planning. Economic growth was there. Industrial production increased from 1929 to 1933 by 100% in case of oil, coal and steel, and new factories, cities where they came into being. But the rapid construction was there and there was a poor working condition. If you see the city of Magnitogorsk, the construction of steel plant was done in 3 years, but this plant stopped for 550 times. In living quarters, in the winter time, 40 degree below, that is minus 40 degree was there. People have to, you know, toilet in open, and you can see, understand, that minus 40, even in minus 15, if you breathe, there is ice in your nose. Minus 40, you can understand. So the situation was not good. The extended schooling system was developed, and proper arrangement were made for the factory workers and peasants in order to allow them to enter the universities. Creches for working women. Cheap public health also was provided. Model living quarters for workers were also there. Here is an example. This is a factory came to be seen as a symbol of socialism. And this poster is saying in this Russian that the smoke from this chimney is the breath of Soviet Russia. Then the children at school and the child in the Magnitogorsk during the 5-year plan. And here factory worker will have lunch. This is their, you can say, the canteen. Now, after Lenin, who? Stalin. So what happened there? Stalinism and collectivization. So this is a poster during collectivization. It is stating that we shall strike at the kulak. We'll talk about kulak working for the decrease in cultivation. So the period of early planned economy, it was linked to disasters of the collectivization of agriculture. Collectivization means the lands are small, so they need to be collected, and then it needs to be collected as a whole by the society. So by 1927 to 1928, the towns in the Soviet Russia were facing acute problem of grain supplies. Though government fixed the prices, at what amount it should be sold, but the peasant refused because the price were less. So Stalin, who came after Lenin, who headed the party, he introduced certain emergency measures because the shortage of grain was there. He believed that these rich peasants and traders, they are holding the stock, munafa khori. So for that, the speculation has to be stopped and supplies should be confiscated. This is what they are doing. So in 1928, the party members, they went to grain producing areas, they supervised or the enforced grain collection and raiding the kulaks. And these kulaks are the, you can say, rich peasants. There are two words coming, that is deported and exiled. Deported means forcibly removing from one's own country, and exiled means forcing to live away from one's own country. So now because well-to-do farmers were there, but the shortage still continued. So the decision was taken finally for the collectivization, that is the collective farm. And it was argued that because of the small size of the land or the holdings, the grain could not be grown in the way it should be grown. So after 1970, the land had been given over to peasants, small size it was. So in order to develop modern farms, they need large farms and they need to eliminate kulaks also. So the land was taken from the peasants and the kulaks, and finally there was a state controlled large farm idea was there. So after this collectivization program of Stalin, from 1929, his party forced all peasants to cultivate the collective farming, that is cultivating collective farms. Okay, it was called as kolkhoz, and many things were done. The authorities also worked for it, but the peasant which worked on this land, and there were enraged peasants also, they resisted the authority, and what they did, they destroyed their livestock, because everyone would not want to do this. So between 1929 to 1931, the livestock, that is the cattle, fell by one third. That is, if they were 100, it became only 30. So those who resisted were either deported or exiled. And as the resistors resisted this collectivization, peasant argued that they are neither rich, they are not even against socialism. So why are they subjected to deporting and exile? But Stalin government allowed certain independent cultivation, but the government didn't support it. So in spite of this collectivization also, this was the second effect, the step. First step we saw here, that is the first step the Stalin took, and second step also he took, that is the collectivization. And then even after doing this, the production did not increase after taking these two steps. In fact, the bad harvest of 1930 to 1933, it led to most devastating famines in Soviet history. Over 4 million died. Here you see a picture of peasant women being gathered to work in large collective farms. So many within the party also criticize the confusion in industrial production under the planned economy and the consequence which took place after collectivization. And what would happen to these people? They were charged with conspiracy, and accusation were made throughout the country, and by 1939, 2 million were in prison and labor camps, those who talked against them. Most were innocent of the crime, but no one spoke for them. And false confessions they were forced to make the false confessions, ultimately they were executed. So what was the global influence of Russian Revolution and the USSR? This existing socialist parties in Europe, they did not approve fully the Bolshevik took power and kept it for a while. But the possibility of workers' state fired people's imagination across the world. Various countries, the communism or communist parties were formed, like Communist Party of Great Britain. And also the Bolshevik encouraged the colonies they have to do this experiment. And many non-Russians from outside the USSR, they participated in the Conference of Peoples of East, that is in 1920, and the Bolshevik founded the Comintern, that is the International Union of Pro-Bolshevik Socialist Parties. So this, some also got education, and by the time of outbreak of Second World War, the USSR had given socialism a global face and world stature. So it was USSR from where the socialism has come out and spread all over. And after this also, by 1950s, it was acknowledged within the city that the style of government in USSR was not very much keeping with the ideals of Russian Revolution. In the world socialist movement, it was recognized that all was not well inside Soviet Union. But a backward country has become a superpower. It was a great power. Industries, agriculture has developed, poor are being fed, and the essential freedom of citizen were denied. But you see, it was growing. So by the end of 20th century, the international reputation of USSR as a socialist country declined. But in each country, the ideas of socialism were rethought in a variety of different ways. So this is the picture of special issues on Lenin of the Indo-Soviet Journal. And because the idea of socialism spread because of this revolution which took place. And these are certain, you know, sources from which we know an Indian arrives in Soviet Russia in 1920, what he has to say. And Rabindranath Tagore also wrote from Russia in 1930. So this is how we get a clear picture of what was happening there. So this is all about the socialism in Europe and French Revolution. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.